On this edition of AIRWaves, NAVAIR responds to an urgent fleet need, delivering new uniforms for pregnant aircrew. Plus, the Naval Air Systems Command welcomes a new leader to its helm. And it was a big year for the Navy's unmanned carrier aviation program as they paved the way for manned and unmanned teaming of carrier-based aircraft. Welcome to the 2021 AIRWaves Year in Review. I'm Michael Lauren Prue. Despite the challenges of COVID-19, we continue to execute our mission successfully, delivering game-changing technology to the fleet. The Navy's unmanned carrier aviation program ended the year with a shipboard demonstration of the MQ-25 unmanned air system prototype aboard USS George H.W. Bush. Government and industry partners tested the ground control system and aircraft in both day and nighttime operations to evaluate the MQ-25's integration into the carrier environment. In September, the program completed its first aerial refueling of an F-35C Lightning II aircraft by the MQ-25, marking the third refueling flight for the test aircraft. Over the summer, the program completed unmanned refueling missions with an FA-18 Super Hornet and E-2D Advanced Hawkeye. Once operational, MQ-25 will provide critical aerial refueling and intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance capabilities to support the air wing of the future. Some major accomplishments for the Navy's Next Generation Jammer Test and Evaluation Team, the Airborne Attack Systems Program Office, and the NAVAIR Test Community. The teams won the Navy's Test and Evaluation Award for improving capabilities for the electronic radar system called NGJ-MB. The system will ultimately replace the legacy ALQ-99 tactical jamming system, currently used aboard the EA-18G Growler aircraft. PMA 234's program manager, Captain Michael Orr, says the teams moved mountains to integrate cutting-edge technology into the system of systems. The U.S. Navy awarded Raytheon Intelligence and Space a multi-million-dollar contract to deliver three ship sets in early 2022, designed to change the way aircraft conduct airborne electronic attacks. Moving supplies to the front lines while keeping sailors and Marines out of harm's way. That's the idea behind developing technology from the Naval Air Warfare Center Aircraft Division at Webster Outlying Field in St. Inigo's, Maryland. It comes in the form of two remotely operated unmanned vehicles capable of resupplying troops from many locations. The TRV-150, known as the Tactical Resupply Unmanned Aircraft System, is a Marine-based platform for tactical resupply primarily on shore. And as the name suggests, the Blue Water Maritime Logistics Unmanned System operates mainly from ship to shore and ship to ship.
What I saw today, right, this is disruptive. And I mean disruptive in the best of ways. Right? This is going to allow us to leap ahead in our ability to support the forces that are forward and make sure the logistics chain doesn't have any kinks in it.
Once the prototypes go into full service on the front lines, simply put, they'll save lives. NOC-AD engineers at Joint Base McGuire-Dix-Lakehurst are developing augmented reality headsets that promise to revolutionize the way they do maintenance and repairs in the future. The Augmented Reality Remote Maintenance Support Service, known as ARRMSS, is a remote system that allows a maintainer or fleet representative to communicate over a network to a subject matter expert somewhere else. Engineers can troubleshoot using a hologram that can be superimposed on the equipment and also use photos, documentation, and other information to make repairs. ARRMSS is expected to be ready for production in 2023. A milestone for teams at NOC-AD's Satellite Production Center in St. Inigo's, Maryland. At a special ceremony, Rear Admiral John Lemon gave the go-ahead to deliver the 100th AGEIS radio control system to the fleet. It was a busy morning for the NOC-AD teams and their industry partners, who worked diligently to get this system to the fleet on time and under budget. The AGEIS system has defended American warships for decades. It's capable of engaging warfare across air, surface, subsurface, and strike environments. The Air-to-Air Missiles Program Office, PMA 259, accepted delivery of the 10,000th AIM-9X Sidewinder for the U.S. Air Force. The missile is the most advanced short-range air-to-air missile in the world. The newest variant, the Block 2, is one of many in the 9X weapon system family. The PMA marked the milestone in May, calling it a great privilege that showcases the team's work in support of the U.S. warfighter and our international partners. Congratulations to the FRC Southeast P-8 Fleet Support Team. They won the Department of Navy Acquisition Excellence Sustainment Team of the Year Award. The award recognizes the team for their dedication and hard work in making every dollar count, as well as achieving the fleet's best readiness benchmarks on mission-capable and full mission-capable aircraft. Program leadership says collaboration and having a common goal was key to the team's success. Each year, the Dawn Acquisition Awards recognize individuals and teams who contribute outstanding achievements to Navy and Marine Corps programs throughout the fiscal year. Fleet Readiness Center Western Pacific accelerated fleet readiness, increasing depot level maintenance on the MH-60 Seahawk aircraft. For the first time in the 70-year partnership between FRC WESTPAC and the NIPI Corporation, 8 H-60 aircraft fill NIPI's aviation facility located just outside Naval Air Facility at Sugi, Japan. The newfound capacity is attributed to a multi-year contract that allows for additional inductions to help meet the readiness requirements of the Naval Aviation Enterprise. This year, FRC WESTPAC performed planned maintenance intervals on 14 MH-60 aircraft. That's a 40% increase over last year. And speaking of meeting readiness goals, the V-22 line at FRC East is turning around aircraft 4 months faster than expected. The decreased overhaul time is a result of the line's recent adoption of a team concept. Under this new way of doing business, one airframe's work leader is responsible for each aircraft. They work with a sheet metal and electrician expert to make daily decisions on scheduling, parts, and staffing needs. The team maintains a spreadsheet detailing required parts and when they will be needed in the process. This long view approach helps the team overcome potential work stoppages. The line's ultimate goal is to meet the fleet's demand for aircraft in 250 days. Fleet Readiness Center East marked a milestone in support of the F-35 Lightning II program, inducting its 100th F-35 for modifications. The induction signifies more than just a number. It represents 8 years of efforts to stand up and grow the F-35 modification line at the depot. Leadership says a new lift fan facility and expansion of the F-35 aircraft line's capacity will add to the depot's continued growth and output. FRC East inducted its first F-35 aircraft for modification in July 2013. The depot provides service, repair, and testing for all three variants of the F-35. The Naval Air Systems Command has a new leader at its helm. Vice Admiral Carl Chevy relieved Vice Admiral Dean Peters during a change of command ceremony at Naval Air Station Patuxent River.
To the men and women of NAVAIR, I could not be happier to be rejoining this team. Our success is defined by delivering the right capability at the right cost at the right time to ensure the fleet can successfully execute their mission and return home safely.
You can learn more about the new NAVAIR commander, his priorities and behaviors for mission success by tuning into our NAVAIR AIRWaves podcast on all your favorite listening apps. The first operational TH-73 Alpha Thrasher training helicopter landed at Naval Air Station Whiting Field in August. The aircraft is now assigned to Training Air Wing 5. It replaced the Chief of Naval Training's TH-57 Bravo Charlie Sea Ranger as the undergraduate training helicopter for the Navy, Marine Corps, and Coast Guard. Leonardo Helicopters in Pennsylvania is also supplying 31 additional Thrashers in the next few years. And the last E-2 Charlie Hawkeye to complete the planned maintenance interval 2 procedure at Fleet Readiness Center Southwest is now back in service at Naval Base Ventura County, California. The Interval 2 procedure involves taking apart the aircraft down to the fuselage. Artisans remove the wings, engines, landing gear, and tail. Then they remove damage and corrosion before putting the aircraft back together. The twin turbopropeller aircraft and its sister airframe serve aboard Navy carriers. Soon the Navy will completely transition to the technologically advanced E-2D. FRC Southwest has already transitioned a team and assets to support the new aircraft going forward. Improving reliability and maintainability, those are the goals behind some new modifications for the nacelle wiring on the V-22 Osprey. The nacelles house the engines, drivetrain, and control components of the world's only tilt-rotor aircraft. Also inside the nacelles, the complex wiring that carries power through the aircraft, which is vital to flying vertically and horizontally. Air Force and Marine maintainers demonstrated the modified nacelles and wiring during a V-22 test flight in April. The refined design is expected to reduce repair time and improve readiness. Now to some milestones for NAVAIR's heavy lift helicopter program. The CH-53 King Stallion is in the middle of operational test and evaluation. The helicopter just completed its first attachment at Marine Corps Air Ground Combat Center in 29 Palms, California. The first operational squadron deployment is scheduled for sometime in 2024. The CH-53 Echo Super Stallion averaged and sustained 62 mission-capable aircraft per month for the last 12 months. The fleet is flying 75% of its available aircraft every month, up from 30% in 2015. Also of note, the Helicopter Countermeasure Squadrons recently celebrated 50 years of service. And in the past year, the HM-12 community surpassed every production and flight hour record since 1995. Adjusting to a growing need in the fleet, this year the folks at Fleet Readiness Center Southwest broke new ground on a new painting facility. The goal is to accommodate a growing workload for the E-2D Hawkeye, the MV and CMV-22 Osprey, as well as the FA-18 Hornet Legacy program. There will be a painting building and a corrosion control facility within the new site. The new complex is set to be complete in the next 2 years. Pregnant aircrew now have the option of wearing one flight suit during their entire pregnancy. That's thanks to a rapid response from the Aircrew Systems Program Office. Working with an in-house tailor, the team created a prototype maternity flight suit uniform and began rolling them out to the fleet in less than 4 months from requirement to fielding. The new MFSUs are fitted to an aircrew height and feature adjustable side panels that are more comfortable, improve safety, and allow for a more customizable fit. For Lieutenant Stephanie Ajuzi, wearing a flight suit is an important part of her job.
Wearing a flight suit puts me on the same ranks as all the other pilots and NFOs that I medically clear. It helps create that rapport with the individuals that I work with.
The adjustable maternity flight suit is designed to fit aircrew through all stages of pregnancy. And that's it for this year-end edition of AIRWaves. See you on the flight line.